There's one thing that unites and sustains all living things on Earth: water. We need it to survive as individuals, as neighborhoods, as a city. Yet we sometimes take our water for granted without thinking about where it comes from, how it gets to us, or what's been done in the past to ensure that we have water today. For Tampa to understand how and where we get our water from, we have to know about the dam. Straddling the Hillsborough River at Rowlett Park near the Rogers Park Golf Course, the dam helps ensure that the city's demand for nearly 80 million gallons of water a day is met. But that hasn't always been the case. When the dam was first conceived in the late 1800s, it had nothing to do with supplying drinking water for Tampa. Situated at the outskirts of Tampa, accessible only on foot, by horseback, or by horse-drawn wagon, the dam has withstood fires, bandits, bombs, undercover agents, floods, and today the dam stands near its original site with a story that coincides with a story of Tampa's growth and development as Tampa has grown around it. As late as 1870, only about 700 people were living in Tampa. There was little in the way of commerce in the area. Agriculture and cattle raising rule today. Tampa was an assemblage of wood-framed structures, sandy streets, and Florida crackers. Those were cattlemen who got their names from the sound their whips made when they were cracked in the air to drive the cattle and the oxen forward. But that was all about to change. Three events occurred almost simultaneously that began to transform Tampa and the surrounding area. The first took place in 1881 when a captain in the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers discovered phosphate pebbles in the Peace River. Phosphate, a precious commodity then and today, increases crop growth and yield. Its discovery near Tampa ignited a phosphate boom that led to nearly 200 companies mining the region by the late 1890s. The second significant event occurred in 1884 when Henry B. Plant completed the last segment of track that brought his railroad to Tampa. Almost overnight, Tampa had rail service to Sanford, then Jacksonville, and ultimately the entire eastern seaboard and points beyond. Plant was so taken by the economic prospects in Tampa, he decided to construct a magnificent hotel on the banks of the Hillsborough River and to develop a deep water port at the southwestern tip of the Inner Bay Peninsula. Tampa no longer was isolated and no longer dependent on agriculture and cattle raising as economic drivers. With the arrival of the trains came the third major change agent, new entrepreneurs, including Ignacio Aya and Vicente Martinez Ybor, two successful cigar manufacturers from Cuba. Enticed by the train service available out of Tampa, Aya and Martinez Ybor also coveted Tampa's climate, the new deep water port, and Tampa's proximity to Cuba, where the tobacco leaf was harvested and there was an available pool of skilled workers. With a growing population and new industries, Martinez Ybor, among others, realized that both industry and workers needed a convenient, reliable way to move between commercial centers. In 1886, that need was met when a steam-driven streetcar line was built between what we now refer to as downtown and Ybor City, an emerging cigar manufacturing center. Soon, a second line was constructed between Ybor City and the bedroom community of Palmetto Beach. This line, unlike the first, was financed by individuals who had no connection to Tampa's growing cigar industry. A few years later, in 1892, Tampa Suburban announced plans to build a third streetcar network that would encompass most, if not all, of the then existing neighborhoods in Tampa. The development of that third streetcar line was followed by conflict. The investors of the first line protested, holding that they had sole rights to construct streetcar lines throughout the city. Their arguments convinced a judge to issue an injunction prohibiting Tampa Suburban from constructing any lines until the matter could be settled in court. In response, the investors of Tampa Suburban went around the injunction by forming a new entity, the Consumers Electric Light and Street Railway Company. Consumers Electric, which promptly proceeded to build streetcar lines all over Tampa to service their growing streetcar operations and the streetlights that were starting to light up the city, Consumers Electric purchased a water power plant situated on the Hillsborough River. The power plant, which consisted of a timber crib dam and a wooden powerhouse, was built originally to operate a sawmill. Consumers Electric began using it to generate hydroelectric power. The demand for electricity quickly outstripped the plant's capacity, so Consumers Electric purchased a new site downstream and in 1896 began constructing a new dam and power station. This site downstream of the original power plant is where Tampa's current dam remains, placing it among the oldest and most important structures in the city of Tampa. The dam, completed in 1897, was constructed using logs and a technique referred to as cribbing. It included a 120-foot-long spillway with a control gate on the north end and an earthen embankment in the back. The hydropower facilities and oil-fired steam generating unit were housed in a large wooden frame structure at the south end of the new dam. Following its completion, the new hydroelectric power plant operated as intended for about a year. Then early in the evening on December 13, 1898, the dam was partially destroyed by a huge explosion. It was suspected that local cattlemen and disgruntled landowners were behind the attack. The somewhat dormant pool of water held back by the dam covered some of the land previously used for grazing, and at the same time attracted scores of mosquitoes. Although the link between mosquitoes and yellow fever had not been established at the time, locals believed that the mosquitoes made the environment unsafe for their families. There's evidence that Consumers Electric compensated the landowners for the loss of pastures for grazing, but an effective way to handle the mosquitoes did not exist. The local press called the attack on the dam the most cowardly crime ever committed in the city or the county. An editorial written shortly after that headline decried that the people opposing the presence of the dam were actuated by a spirit of revenge, and that their purpose seems to be to block the wheels of progress regardless of the best interests of the community. A $2,500 reward, that would be about $72,000 in today's dollars, was offered for the arrest and conviction of those responsible for the explosion. Four men were arrested and tried the following year. However, for reasons that remain unclear in the documentation, the presiding judge issued a directed verdict of acquittal. The prosecutor for the state was Peter O. Knight, a Consumers Electric investor and the man who eventually became president of the Tampa Electric Company, a position he held for 22 years. Whatever the saboteurs' motivations, their move to damage the dam proved to be devastating to Consumers Electric. The high cost of building the infrastructure for the streetcar systems, coupled with lower than expected revenues that resulted from a rate war between competing streetcar lines and the cost of repairing the damage to the dam, proved to be too much. Consumers Electric went bankrupt. Their assets, including the dam, were purchased by a new company, the Tampa Electric Company, TECO, financed jointly by Stone and Webster, an engineering services company out of Massachusetts, and several prominent Tampa locals. As Tampa continued to grow, TECO maintained and operated the dam and power generating facilities on the Hillsborough River for nearly 20 years until the summer of 1916. On June 28, 1916, the dam tender was making his usual rounds when he observed two men at the north end of the dam. When he called out to them, they quickly got into a waiting boat and paddled away. Approaching the gate, he heard what he later described as a muffled explosion under the water, accompanied by a small amount of smoke and gases that smelled like sulfur. The explosion did not cause any damage to the dam. Since the company had not received any complaints about the dam for a number of years, the motive for the attack is unknown. For safety, TECO added a watchman to guard the facility at night. The added security helped for a couple of months and all remained quiet. And then on August 17th, a much more ominous incident unfolded. At about 1 a.m., the dam tender and the night watchman were taken hostage at gunpoint by about 20 masked men. The power station was set afire. The watchman told the intruders that unless he arrived at his nearby home at his usual time, his wife was sure to sound an alarm. The kidnappers released him, but threatened to kill him if he alerted anyone. He ignored their threat, and once released, immediately went to waken the chief engineer, who went directly to the power station to put out the fire. And meanwhile, the dam operator, still captive, heard a whistle in the distant night air. One of his captors returned the whistle and then released the operator with instructions that he should go home. The intruders then quickly disappeared into the night. The just-released dam operator ignored his captors too and stayed to help extinguish the fire before heading home. When he got there, he discovered that the telephone wire to his house had been cut. He then went by horseback to a nearby general store to place a call to his superiors to alert them of the problem. By daybreak, the dam and power station were surrounded by TECO officials and local law enforcement. While inspecting the site, they discovered a large wooden box containing 196 sticks of dynamite tied to four fuses. Three of the fuses fizzled out shortly after being lit. The fourth had burned a bit long, burning down to only a few inches shy of the dynamite-filled box before it fizzled out too. Investigators surmised that the distant whistle the operator heard was signaling the operator's captors that the fuses were lit and they should leave. Following the initial on-scene gathering of evidence, TECO hired the famed Pinkerton Detective Agency to conduct an investigation. And on August 20th, a Pinkerton representative wrote from the company's Atlanta office, "Regarding the recent case, we'll have a man ready to send forward within a few days. Of course, you know that we'll have to make a careful selection and we'll have to detail a man who has plenty of grit. And we are now proceeding to make a good man available. Now, concerning devices so that we can exchange telegrams without exposing our business, Mr. Carpenter has furnished you with a cipher and we're attaching some code words that can be used in connection with that cipher." 2 days later, a second box was recovered containing a similar number of dynamite sticks as the box found immediately after the incident. By August 25th, the Pinkerton agency assigned an agent to come to Tampa. He was referred to only as Operative Number 5. In addition to bringing on the Pinkerton agency, Tampa Electric and a local group of industrialists announced that a reward in the amount of $3,500 would be given to anyone who had information leading to an arrest and conviction of the people behind the attack. August gave way to September. Operative Number 5 became ill and had to retire from the assignment. There's no record of a second operative being assigned. Interest in identifying the culprits waned, and ultimately, there was no arrest or conviction. Everyone just moved on. 4 years later, in 1920, TECO and the dam tender simultaneously received this written threat. "Warning to the people who attend to the dam. Dear gentlemen, I'm sorry to say, but it is my duty to command you to open the dam and let the water out by October 15th, 1920. Otherwise, it'll be blown up immediately after October 15th, 1920. Thank you, the bomb setter." Nothing came of this threat, but by this time, the dam and power generating facilities, although they remained in use, were showing signs of wear and were in need of repairs and upgrades. In 1923, Tampa Electric offered to sell the facility and the associated properties to Tampa for the relatively high price of $200,000. Given the condition of the site, the city declined. Tampa Electric looked for other options. More than 50,000 people now called Tampa home. The cigar, real estate, and tourism industries were booming. More electric power was needed. In 1925, Tampa Electric decided to rehabilitate and improve the dam and power station. Now, to fully understand the decision made to make that level of investment, we have to look at the history of Tampa's water supply and its ever-growing need for more water supplied more reliably. In 1885, following fires that could not be effectively fought using the means then available, the city of Tampa awarded a franchise to the Holly Manufacturing Company of Lockport, New York, to supply water to as many as 10,000 residents. The company soon abandoned the agreement after concluding that expected revenues from the venture would not be sufficient to cover expenses. Despite several attempts, the city was not able to attract another franchisee until after it incorporated in 1887. With incorporation came the ability to obligate itself to pay for public works. With that in hand, the city granted a 35-year franchise to Jeter Boardman Water Works Company to provide Tampa with a public water supply. A yellow fever epidemic that same year delayed construction, but by 1889, 2 years after the initial works, consisting of a deep well located at Jefferson Avenue and 6th Street and a storage tank, were completed. Jeter Boardman Water Works eventually constructed several pumping stations and a total of 45 wells. They also made use of Magby Spring, located near the corner of Highland and Henderson. In 2006, Magby Spring was renamed Eulalie Spring, and today the corner of Highland and Henderson is Waterworks Park. The Jeter Boardman Water Works Company supplied water to Tampa's growing population for the entire 35-year period of the agreement, although 22 years into the agreement, they were inundated with complaints about hard water, inadequate expansion planning, high rates, and demands for improved service. In 1922, the city retained the services of Nicholas S. Hill, Jr., an engineer from New York, to evaluate options for the future. After studying the matter for more than a year, Hill recommended that the city construct a modern filtration plant on the Hillsborough River to be situated just upstream of Tampa Electric's power generating dam. The construction began in 1924. In addition to the filtration plant, a large diameter transmission main was built to carry water to the city's neighborhoods. The initial 15 million gallons per day capacity of the plant was double the amount of water being supplied through the Jeter Boardman Water Works franchise, and the city was certain that the plant could be expanded in the future. It was the construction of the city's water filtration plant that triggered TECO's decision to repair their dam in 1925. If TECO abandoned the dam, the city would have no choice but to build a new one. The newly constructed water treatment plant depended on the pool of water the dam provided to operate. TECO's senior managers were certain that if the city constructed a new dam to pool water for the water plant, the design would incorporate electrical generating facilities. That would mean TECO would lose its monopoly as the only producers of electricity for Tampa. Following completion of the needed repairs to the dam, Tampa Electric and the water treatment plant stood side by side along the Hillsborough River, one generating hydroelectric power and one producing drinking water. And then a 1933 natural disaster ended the use of hydroelectric power for Tampa. It was late in the summer. A series of complex storms caused the most significant flood ever recorded on the Hillsborough River. The floodwaters overtopped the dam and forged a new channel south of the power station. As a consequence, the dam and power station no longer were on the riverbanks, but were setting on an island in the middle of the flooded river. TECO abandoned the site. After the flooding and dam failure, river levels dropped almost as quickly as they rose. The water plant was able to continue operation during the flood and its aftermath, but only at a reduced capacity. To increase the reliability of the city's water supply, Hill, the plant's designer, was authorized to conduct an assessment of options related to the dam TECO had abandoned. In a quickly prepared report, Hill concluded that the dam, if repaired, would have no continued value in the production of electricity for either TECO or for the city. The report, somewhat surprisingly, also concluded that while desirable, it was not essential to impound water for the benefit of the operation of the water production plant. Hill concluded that the unregulated flow of the river was sufficient to meet the water supply requirements for a population equal to 2.5 times Tampa's population at the time, or up to 260,000 people. Hill also concluded that unless funds were made available from government sources, financing the repair or replacement of the abandoned dam would be difficult, and thus overwhelmed by the situation, and with an assurance from Hill that the river could reliably provide water for some unspecified period of time into the future, the city took no action. The dam remained abandoned in its battered and bruised condition into World War II. As Axis forces surrendered in Tunisia and the Allies landed in Sicily in 1943, the everyday concerns of city life continued for Tampa and its leaders, including the question of how to fund the now needed improvements to the city's water system to keep pace with an ever-growing population. The city's water production plant, completed almost 20 years earlier in 1925 and designed to treat a maximum of 12 million gallons a day, now was producing nearly 1.5 times that much. Something had to be done about the dam to ensure an adequate supply of water for current and future demands. Members of the Board of Aldermen, as City Council was referred to in those days, were now so concerned about the fate of the dam and water for Tampa that one of the aldermen proposed that the city purchase the whole of the Tampa Electric Company, not just the abandoned dam on the river. Although the suggestion did not find favor with the rest of the board, at the urging of then-Mayor Robert E.L. Chancy, they gave serious consideration to a generous offer made by the electric company. Tampa Electric offered to lease the dam and all of the related property, including the so-called overflowed land, to the city for $5 a year for a period of 1,000 years. Debate ensued, and as it unfolded, the city instructed its municipal engineers consultant, Robert & Company of Atlanta, to determine how to go about increasing the water plant's capacity and repairing the dam. Robert & Company also were authorized to prepare construction plans for both projects and to submit an application for federal aid. In August of 1943, the U.S. War Production Board and the U.S. Public Health Service demanded that the city curtail its plans, that both groups believed that the needed increase in water supply capacity could be achieved from existing wells. The city rejected this notion because of past troubles with the quality of well water. Undaunted by federal demands, and despite the fact that it did not yet control the dam site, the city submitted an application to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers in 1943 for a permit to rebuild the dam. Then early in January, the city got the first of 3 pieces of good news. First, the Federal Works Agency notified the city that it had allocated about $106,000 in funding for the city's water improvement program, subject to appropriation by Congress. Then in late May, Tampa Electric announced that it would deed the dam, the 420 acres surrounding it, and overflow rights to the 1,500 acres of land upstream of the dam to the city. There was one stipulation. TECO would continue as the sole provider of electricity for Tampa. That stipulation was protected by a requirement that should the city ever decide to generate electricity for sale, it would be obligated to compensate Tampa Electric in the sum of $42,000. To announce the agreement, TECO placed an ad in the Tampa Tribune on May 29, 1944 that read, "This company is a citizen of Tampa and has been for 51 years. Our welfare and our future are dependent entirely upon the welfare and future of Tampa. We are part of Tampa, and unlike most businesses, could not move our facilities away from here even if we wanted to. Helping to make Tampa prosperous and a good place in which to live is a matter of direct interest to us. That's why we gave the properties of our dam to the city of Tampa." The year following TECO's gift of the dam to the city, Tampa's streetcar system, the reason the original dam was constructed in 1896, was dismantled. The third piece of good news came in September of 1894. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers issued the construction permit to rebuild the dam. Groundbreaking followed just 1 month later, and work was completed the following year, just in time for the economic expansion that followed the end of World War II. During the post-war years, the reconstructed expanded dam served the city without incident until 1960, when Mother Nature hit Tampa again and again and again. In March 1960, 13 and a half inches of rain fell on Tampa over a three-day period. As a result, peak river flow reached a level second only to the record levels set by the 1933 storms. That had flooded the dam site. With an expanded population both upstream and downstream of the dam, the floodwaters caused considerable property damage. Dozens of roads were washed out by the downpour, and nearly 8,000 Hillsborough County residents were evacuated from their homes. Just a few months later, as things were returning to normal, Tropical Storm Brenda moved ashore from the Gulf of Mexico in July, and more than 20 inches of rain fell, followed by another 13 and a half inches over another eight-day period. Mayor Julian Lane advised residents living in low-lying areas to be prepared to leave their homes if necessary. Some of them eventually were forced to do so after a number of flashboards on the crest of the dam collapsed. And then just a month later, Hurricane Donna, a Category 4 storm, came roaring through Florida, depositing another 8-plus inches of rain in an already saturated region. Evacuation orders were issued, tens of thousands of sandbags were distributed, and municipal emergency response teams were mobilized. Although Tampa was spared the full brunt of the storm, the resulting rains caused additional flooding and property damage in the Park Circle and Sulphur Springs neighborhoods. In the immediate aftermath of the storms, the city began work on a two-year project to replace the existing flashboards at the crest of the dam with 15 mechanical gates supported by a walkway that extended from one end of the spillway to the other. At the same time, soggy residents clamored for a more permanent solution to flood control. The Tampa Tribune reported that officials of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers had inspected Hillsborough River flood conditions from the air, and federal work to solve the problem still appeared to be years off. The same article also reported that Congress had just appropriated $100,000 for the Corps to conduct a flood control feasibility study of four Florida river basins, the Hillsborough, the Ocklawaha, the Withlacoochee, and Peace. Only one of the projects envisioned for those four basins, the Tampa Bypass Canal, was completed. The bypass canal was designed to divert floodwaters around Tampa and Temple Terrace and take them down the constructed canal to McKay Bay. Spearheaded by the newly formed Southwest Florida Water Management District, construction on the bypass canal started in 1966. The canal became operational in 1978. This new flood control took significant pressure off the dam, so much so that when the city upgraded the dam in 2000, the 15 crest gates installed in 1960 were replaced by just six. Aside from its vibrant history, the value of the dam resides in its value to a community. This structure, standing in the midst of the neighborhoods of central Tampa, has served the needs of Tampa residents since the late 1800s. First, as part of a lumber mill, then by providing hydroelectricity to power streetcars and streetlights. And finally, the dam helps provide vital, potable water for Tampa while safeguarding freshwater flows of up to 15 million gallons a day to ensure consistent downstream water levels. Indeed, the dam is a vital piece of Tampa's past, present, and future growth, vitality, and quality of life.